Welcome. I am so glad to see all of you here tonight. This is our celebration of the ideas of good governance. I am so glad to see so many of you true believers. The opinion headline in today's Seattle Times proclaimed, "Voters are clueless." As I was trying to figure out how to approach tonight, this was actually on Friday morning, a friend sent me an editorial cartoon. It showed two smiling politicians with armbands with dollar signs, looking out at their crowd, all waving signs that say things like, "We want dirtier air and water. Send our jobs overseas. Stop giving us benefits from our tax money. Limit our internet freedom. Don't tell us what's in our food. Yes to costly health care." We are not those people. We are not clueless. We are the League of Women Voters. I woke yesterday with truth, justice, and the American way running through my head. When I Googled it, I discovered that the announcer says, disguised as Clark Kent, he fought for those values. As Superman, he leaped tall buildings with a single bound. But as Clark Kent, he lived amongst the rest of us. That is where the fight is, amongst the rest of us. We of the League do not join the battles of bad politics. Instead, we continuously strive to use our ideals of good governance and good governing to keep us focused on what truly is the prize. The League promotes citizenship. We work to inform and energize citizen participation in our governing. We promote democracy. We live by the statement that democracy is not a spectator sport. I hope you have read the information on the posters we've arranged, intending to lead you into the conversation we're continuing between our speakers tonight. Dave Ross is the man who rescued me years ago on Cairo Radio by giving me the opportunity to hear intelligent conversations about what was going on in the world. He continues in that role on Cairo FM still. Alan Durning, as founder and director of Sightline Institute, has brought together huge resources of information from the many writers and researchers who are concerned with the kind of governing issues we of the League are. Most recently, he is writing a series of articles posted on sightline.org titled, "What Democracy Looks Like." I'm going to interrupt here to call attention to the fact that Alan is something more than all of those things that I've said. He is Gene Durning's son. She actually told me that she really didn't know whether she would come tonight because she was getting so many other chances this week to see her son. So I'm awfully glad that she came. And she told me the reason she decided she needed to come was because she'd heard that Alan had said the reason he was willing to come was because of how important the league had been to his mother. So I want us all to take a step back and think about how important things are to our mothers, as well as thinking about how important we mothers feel the things that our children are about are important. So I just want to take a minute to say, League of Women Voters, mothers and fathers, sons and daughters, hooray. Tonight, Dave is going to continue in his role as master interviewer. Alan will be the interviewee, and then the roles will reverse so that Alan can ask questions of Dave. We intend that all that will stimulate questions and answers from you. That's what we want to leave with. No, that's what we want you to leave with tonight, the feeling that you have engaged in a conversation really worth having. We have microphones on each side so the conversation can extend into the audience. We want all of us to join in energized conversation about how we will continue our good fight for truth, justice, and the American way. That we recognize each other as fellow Clark Kents. That we bring the superpowers of our intelligence, talent, and belief that we can bring good governance to our country. That we leave tonight with energy to take on the work that those goals do continue to demand. So I'd like you all to welcome Dave Ross and Alan Durning. We will be sitting here.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting us tonight. 10 years ago, my brief career as a politician came to an ignominious end when I lost the 8th District Congressional seat race by about 17,000 votes. Up until that time, I had, for the five previous months, spent about 4 hours a day, 4 to 5 days a week, on a telephone in my dining room, calling people whose names have been taken out of the donor list for the Seattle Opera, the Mercer Island phone directory, and various lists of rich people to get them to give money to my campaign. I raised $500,000 for the primary, which I won, and I raised $1 million for the general election, which I lost. But my $1.5 million was only a small portion of the money spent in that election. With the addition of outside money and the money that my opponent Dave Reichert had raised, in all, on that 8th District Congressional race in 2004, $8.5 million was spent, making both of us incredibly famous. I never saw a dime of the money I raised. It all went directly, not all of it, but most of it, went directly to Como 4, King 5, and Cairo 7. The rest went to direct mail. And at the end of that process, I had a pile of business cards about that high in this hand, and a pile of business cards about that high in this hand, and all the things that these people had asked me to do were in direct conflict with all the things these people had asked me to do. So maybe it was a blessing that I didn't win. How many people here think too much money is spent on politics? I had a feeling everybody was already on board with that. So we probably don't have to explain that there is a lot of money spent on politics. But what Alan's done a great job of is documenting where it comes from and what people seem to expect in exchange for it. It's sort of a shady area, isn't it? Because if you give somebody money to take a certain vote on a certain day in a certain way, that's bribery.
Yeah.
That's a quid pro quo. But if you give somebody a pile of money on the understanding that they will very probably vote a certain way on a certain day without really saying so, that's called good government. Am I close?
Yeah, that's about right. You know, and this is the reasoning that's behind the problem we have with the Supreme Court and Citizens United. The Supreme Court has interpreted corruption as consisting exclusively of the trading of money for votes. I got to back up and say, it's really a joy to listen to his voice, right? I kind of want to not talk very much just so we can hear him, that resonant voice.
Just answer the question, Alan.
Yeah. I'll answer it when I want to. my mom's here. She'll mess you up.
I don't doubt it.
Okay, so Citizens United says the only kind of corruption that legislatures can pass laws to limit is quid pro quo corruption, where you're trading money for votes. But of course, the problem we have is not really quid pro quo corruption. In fact, on that measure, we have one of the cleanest democracies maybe in the history of the planet. I mean, there's a little bit of it that goes on. Every once in a while, someone gets caught in a sting. But the problem is systemic corruption. The corruption that politicians, as you experienced, spend most of their working hours raising money. If you are a successful politician in the United States of America, your first job is raising money. If you're a member of the Democratic caucus in the U.S. House of Representatives, the teachings from the caucus are to spend 4 hours a day on the phone raising money, and then to spend 2 hours either on the floor or in committee meetings. Right, so you're supposed to spend, they're telling you to spend more of your time raising money than.
Right. Who does it best? Give me some names.
Well, in the Northwest, the league leader in fundraising is Senator Patty Murray. Think about how many years she's been spending 4 to 6 hours a day on the phone raising money. This is not just during campaign season, it's all the time, it's what they do. She's a telemarketer who moonlights running the government. Now, the fact that we get some good results from the system is a good thing, but it should be a surprise considering that our elected leaders, you know, Patty Murray has raised $45 million for her own campaigns and then helped raise a lot of more money for other people. Reichert has raised, what is it, $14 million? Jay Inslee's raised $24 million. The system is one in which people who succeed are good at fundraising. And to be good at fundraising, you develop a sixth sense for what do funders want. That's the problem. That's the systemic corruption. It's not that the people are going to call you and demand a favor. It's that you're going to anticipate the favor they want. You're going to work on issues that they care about. You're not going to work on issues that other people care about. And there's academic research now that shows this very clearly. If you look at the public opinion research broken down by income class of residents of a state, and you look at the votes, the voting records of members of Senate from those states, you can there are academics, political scientists, what they do, you know, they gather, you know, 3,000 opinion polls and break out the issues and they study all this too, and they do fancy math and so on. And what they've found is that the political views of people in the top third of the income ladder in a state, their views are closely reflected in the votes by the U.S. senator from that state.
Mm-hmm. Well, it makes sense. Why would you give that much money to somebody that you couldn't stand?
Yeah. the middle class, there is no correlation whatsoever between the political views of the middle class in a state and the senator's votes in that state. There is an inverse correlation between the views of the bottom third of the income ladder and the senator's votes on positions.
Now, how much of that is due to who gives the money as opposed to who shows up at the polls? Because certainly when we're talking about people in the lower income strata, their turnout has been pathetic over the years.
Turnout is lower, certainly. But some of them vote, you know? I mean, if you're a politician and you're thinking you're counting votes, you're not going to want to vote intentionally against the views of one-third of the, right, of your constituents. I think the issue is the systemic corruption that in our system, people who succeed spend most of their time talking to rich people.
Right.
That's sort of their social milieu.
Right, but they have to get, and this is the fundamental paradox, right? They spend most of their time talking to rich people who represent a tiny minority of the voting population. Mm-hmm. The vast majority, of course, are not political donors. So it would seem logical that unless people had no idea what their interests were, the rich would be outvoted every single time, mm-hmm. right? So why doesn't that happen?
That's a good question.
That's why I asked it.
Yeah. So the way that voters make their decisions in elections is a puzzling thing. You have to remember that most of us are not spending their Saturday night at a League of Women Voters meeting, right? We're somewhat unusual that we pay this much attention to public policy issues and so on. Most people are making their decisions based on a general impression of who's more trustworthy, who's more like them, mm-hmm. whose values might reflect their own. And the other thing to note is that most people in America think that politicians are not someone you'd want to hang around with. Most Americans are disgusted by the process of politics. They think government is not trustworthy. Mm-hmm. And so they vote sort of holding their nose, right? And that's a big part of the problem. People don't want to know more about it. They think it's ugly and messed
up.
Right,
but I mean, based on what you
said. And they vote against their interest.
They vote against their interest, right. So there must be some level of lying going on here if they represent a minority of people in terms of the point of view that they hold, right? And yet are voted in by a majority of people whose view they don't hold, but who they have to pretend to hold to win, right?
That's right.
All right, so there should be a law against lying, shouldn't there?
Yeah, so it's one thing to lie, and it's another thing to pick what you talk about. So most of political campaigns consist of picking what to talk about and trying to change the subject mm-hmm. to the things on which you can move voters emotionally. The negative campaigning is a lot about that. And another part of negative campaigning is to suppress turnout, to make your opponent's supporters mm-hmm. so disgusted by the whole process that they won't bother to vote. And if you can suppress their turnout more than you suppress your own voters' turnout.
So this is how the money gets spent, then?
This is how the money gets spent, yeah. This cycle, midterm election, $4 billion, more or less. About $1 billion of that was outside money, that is from super PACs and what they call social welfare groups. That's the dark money where we don't even know exactly where it comes from. $1 billion out of the four was from outside groups, and that's the part that's growing fast, the $3 billion raised by mm-hmm. candidates and parties. It's a lot of money.
So is the only way to limit this to limit the money?
So here's the problem. The Supreme Court says money is speech, and that speech is absolutely sacrosanct, right?
Right.
That's the reading of the Supreme of the reading of the Constitution. And so the court has said there are some things you can do. You can require disclosure, and Washington State has probably the best public disclosure system in the country, though there's some improvements that we could see. And the Supreme Court says, sure, if you want to create a voluntary system through which you provide public money to candidates and they opt into that, you're not violating anybody's mm-hmm. rights. But that's not what voters want to do. What voters want to do is shorten the campaigns, limit how much money candidates can spend, limit how much money can be given. They want to eliminate the super PACs and all the rest. 76% of Republicans want to overturn Citizens United, 85% of Democrats want to overturn Citizens United. The public is absolutely appalled.
They want limits.
They want it strictly limited. They basically want what Canada has. Canadian election systems, candidates do not spend time dialing for dollars.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
They also elected a cocaine-sniffing mayor.
In Toronto, they did. You guys are probably bored by now the quote from Winston Churchill, that democracy is the worst possible form of government aside from all others. But there's no guarantee that solving the money problem will make everyone smart. You know, I'm supposed to ask you questions too, and so
not yet. I ask you questions for the first time. All right, so people want to regulate the money, they want to reduce the money, but the Supreme Court won't let them. We understand that the money tends to create the kind of politicians who are good at raising it, and therefore they have to be good at schmoozing with rich people, and therefore they know, without it having to be stated, that they have to represent the viewpoints of the rich. So the option that seems to be open to us is to somehow wean ourselves from being manipulated by the ads they buy, whether those are ads that exaggerate their own accomplishments, diminish the other person's accomplishments, or seek to confuse and frighten us so that we don't go to the polls.
Right.
Is that possible? Is it possible to create an electorate that is independently informed and therefore immune to these manipulations?
Mm. Right. So we can better inform voters so that the money doesn't matter as much. That's one set of strategies. And we can also we can try to provide public money to have a public system of finance. There are ways that I can imagine we get there. It's challenging, but it's not impossible. So we should spend a minute about each of those things, right?
Go ahead.
So one of the things I'm most excited about reforming the initiative process in Washington, Oregon. In Washington, probably the initiative process is the most egregious case of financial obscenity. For example, 2 years ago with Monsanto and the grocery manufacturers, Coke and Pepsi and so on, spending $22 million, only $600 of which was collected in the state of Washington, to bombard voters with their message against labeling foods for GMOs. That's more money than both major party candidates spent combined running for governor. That's more money than was spent on every single legislative race in the state combined, right? But the Supreme Court says there can't be any corruption in an initiative race because you can't bribe somebody. There's no politician to be bribed, right? So therefore, there's no limits on total spending. There's no limits on individual contribution, and the fundraisers have found ways to make it possible to hide identity in many cases, so there isn't even full disclosure.
Let me interrupt for a moment. Was anybody at all mystified by what was behind that money? Who was paying for it? It's like the liquor initiative. Everybody knew that that Costco and the big box stores wanted to privatize liquor, and you'd have to be a moron to think they did it to lower the price of liquor, right? So, I mean,
They wanted to corral the sale. They wanted to get the business. And Costco now has about 10% of the liquor market in the state.
I mean, sometimes you can look at the money and understand that you're being manipulated, and if you allow yourself to be manipulated, even though you understand that you're being manipulated, who's to blame there?
I think the system is to blame. I mean, it's easy to say voters ought to just make themselves immune. But if we don't create a democracy in which the truth flows more easily, then, it'd be nice if people were smarter, paid more attention.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to legislate that. That's like saying, what's the old quote about the manager of the baseball team saying, all fly balls will be caught. You got to pick better fielders and train them better and so on. But so the thing I was trying to say about what I'm excited about is Oregon is now doing this thing that they call a citizen initiative review panel. And we're trying to bring it to Washington next year. It's like a jury. Put 20 people together in a room for 2 weeks. They bring in the proponents of an initiative and the opponents of the initiative, and they bring in independent experts. And this group of citizens who are randomly, not randomly selected, they're selected to represent the demographic, political, and geographic diversity of the state. So it's a cross-section. And they get together and they discuss, they debate, they deliberate. It's all moderated to maintain an allegiance to the facts and respect and civility among
and
the
participants.
And
they're paid, right?
They get a stipend, right? At the end of the process, they make a consensus statement that's published in the voter's pamphlet. They've done it two cycles in Oregon. No, they've just done it a third cycle in Oregon. And at first, no one knew what it was, right? What's this page in the voter's pamphlet? I don't know what that is, right? But the University of Washington had a researcher who's been monitoring this closely. And the awareness of it keeps increasing among the voters. And what the voters who are paying attention, which is now maybe a third of the voters overall in Oregon who are actually paying attention to this, are reading it closely, believe it and trust it more than any other source of information, and say that it is helpful to them in making their decisions. It's hard to find out whether they actually change their position or not. But if you can imagine a world where we have, for every initiative, you've gone through this process, and you have a consensus statement by a cross-section of voters from the state in the voter's pamphlet. You know what that is. You know that they've spent a whole week studying this. And this is what they say the truth is. And they recommend a yes vote or a no vote by, 2-1 or by a narrow majority, whatever. It makes it harder. The money people put out a lot more money to overcome that, right? It helps to bolster people's independent decision-making. So things like that, I think, can reduce how much money matters, right?
I think that's a great idea. I think the voter's pamphlet itself is a great idea, which didn't exist in New York, where I come from. And we have a little family ritual a couple of days before Election Day, where we sit down and read it and discuss among ourselves the various statements. And if there's one that looks suspicious, we Google it now. And that, which brings up another thing. Now with the prevalence of so much media available in your pocket, you're no longer at the whim of a flyer in the mail or even a newspaper article. You can Google a candidate's name and read almost anything you want about him. The question is whether people spend the time. And I think if I had to put the blame on anything, it's that the only way you can manipulate people as effectively as the money does is if you have an electorate that is willing to spend all of 30 seconds making up its mind. Which usually happens, on Election Day, when you say, that ballot is still on my kitchen table, and some of them are just going to throw it away, and those that make up their mind are just going to rip right through it as fast as they can, because it's a hassle. And I don't know how money restrictions or truth juries help if you have an electorate that takes things as casually as that. I've stumped you now.
No, I'm just happy. That's a pretty sour view of a normal citizen, that they're sort of casual about it. I'm happy I don't have that cynical view of the world.
If I'm wrong, just say so.
Well,
question why it is people are so gullible.
Yeah. So let me mention an example I was just reading about yesterday, because I think it's further proof of the degree to which people are responding to the system as they understand it. That people have fairly accurate understanding of how systemically corrupted the current system is, and that their participation is therefore ambivalent. Right? I'm presented with lousy choices. I have, corporate candidate A or other corporate plus labor candidate B, and I don't love either of them. Okay. Oakland now does its city elections using a different voting system in which you rank your top
voting.
Three choices, right? They don't have a primary. So you have the election among the largest number of voters. You have it only in the general, right? So they use rank voting. They've just done the second round of electing a mayor through the rank voting system. The first round, 4 years ago, there were a bunch of independent expenditures running negative against certain of the candidates, and they completely failed. What it did was it put a negative light on the candidates who voters correctly identified as the intended beneficiaries of these mm-hmm. negative. And those guys kind of lost. In rank voting, you want to be everybody's first choice, but if you can't be their first choice, you'd really like to be their second choice. And if you can't be their second choice, you really want to be their third choice. Because how it works is the first round votes go to whoever they vote for, right? And then you start eliminating the people who've lost, and all their votes get retallied. So if your first choice was the sixth place finisher, your first choice vote is peeled off, and the second vote, your second choice shows up, and so your ballot gets moved over to whoever the winner is, and you keep doing that round after round. So you want to be liked by everybody. And so what happened in Oakland, and this has happened in Minneapolis and St. Paul and Portland, Maine, and so other cities are trying to do this, is that candidates run positive campaigns. They don't run negative because they run negative, they're going to be disliked. They're going to push themselves down the list. The money doesn't matter as much. Advertising matters less. Voter contact matters mm-hmm. more. And interestingly, participation in that election has gone way up. So the way you can tell this is that it's normal to have what's called ballot drop-off. So you might have, you know, say you have 100,000 votes in the city of Portland for governor. Mm-hmm. But maybe only 60,000 people participate right. in the city council race, right? The races that they've converted to ranked choice voting, they're getting 95 to 97% of the ballots filled in for those races.
Now, how many candidates on a ranked choice ballot, since there's no primary, how many candidates might you see on a typical ballot?
It's hard to say what's typical yet because it's not used in many places. In Oakland, there were 15. In Minneapolis, last year, there were, I think, 7 candidates. And in both cases, the winners were not the biggest spenders. They were the candidates who had run the most sort of grassrootsy contact voters mm-hmm. kind of a deal.
And do you have to rank everybody, or no. can you just rank as many as you...
Right, so this is the detail of the voting system that gets really exciting to me and no one else cares about. No. But in Oakland, you ranked your top 3.
It's already sounding like the way they score soccer. But, I mean, that's typical.
How do they score soccer? You make a goal or you don't make a goal? What do you mean?
Oh, no.
Oh, okay.
I'll explain it to you if you have a month.
In Oakland, it was top 3. In some places, you might rank 5.
Yeah.
You know, The potential of this alternative voting system is not just the mayor's races, but congressional races. And that's where the power would be enormous, mm-hmm. right? So we have in Congress and in our legislatures, most of the seats are safe, right? And there are certain seats that are designed to be competitive.
Right.
Right? So we have redistricting and Slade Gorton and Tim C. sit in a room for a while and they draw up this map and all the incumbents from each party get a safe seat. Jim McDermott gets 85% of the vote.
He only got 79 this year.
So only 79, right? And then we draw one district, Susan DelBene's district. What number is that?
One.
Number one,
yeah.
right? That's supposed to be 50-50. And obviously someone did the math wrong because it turned out to be 54.
Well, there are certain problems with her opponent this year. But
yeah, so... That's the way the system works, right? Is you draw safe seats, and then you have certain competitive districts, and that's where all the money goes. And most voters, therefore, are in a safe seat. Their vote kind of doesn't matter. If you instead had, say, Washington divided into 2 districts with 5 members of Congress each, and you rank-choiced your preferences, and the top vote-getters in each of those 2 districts won, so you'd have 5 members of Congress from each of those districts, you'd have a Republican from Greater Seattle, along with probably a socialist, mm-hmm. and a bunch of centrists, and you'd have a Democrat from Yakima or something, along with so on and so forth. Everyone's vote would matter in each of those
places.
Is there
any legal hurdle to doing something like that?
Well, there's something in federal law. But we could do... Now, here's the thing. We need to start this at the city level. This is my grand scheme. I said this, right? My next articles are going to be about this. You could start this at the city level, where it'd be like... falling off a log. We already elect, you live on Mercer Island, mm-hmm. right? Mercer Island, like Seattle used to have, is a bunch of at-large numbered seats for your city council.
Yeah.
So you pick, I'm going to run for seat 1, I'm going to run for seat 2, or whatever, right? How many seats are there?
I think there's 9.
9 seats?
7.
7 on Mercer Island, right? So instead of having numbered seats, you could say, okay, the top 7 vote getters. Everyone's in the same pool. You list your top 7 or 9 right. or whatever you want to do, right? Until people get used to it, right? Do a bunch of city elections this way. People see, oh, it's good. I get a better diversity. There are no safe seats anymore, right? And then after people are used to that, then we can start doing statewide. What Washington could do without a change in the Constitution is to increase from 2 to 3 the number of representatives in each legislative district, and you could elect them by ranked choice voting. The result of that would be, with 3-member districts, you would have a Democrat in Yakima, and you'd have a Republican. Well, you'd certainly have a Republican on the east side. You might not have it in Seattle, right? But more importantly, you wouldn't have safe seats anymore.
Yeah.
Right. So everyone's votes.
So you feel this is doable? I've heard of ranked choice proposed for years, and once you sit down and figure it out, you're absolutely right. It seems to lead to much better candidates, but people glaze over the first time you go through the explanation. And I think 15 candidates on a general election ballot would be just poison to the idea, unless you had a system where instead.
I don't know. Are you guys glazed over?
No. This is not the typical audience.
This is not the typical.
These people
audience.
Are not moved by money in any way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people showed up for candidate forum. Over 3
in the primary.
Yes.
Well, the problem is, though, the primaries are some of the least attended elections that we hold.
Right.
No, but there's so many people interested in it. Mm-hmm. So if that's the actual election, 12 people come.
Yeah.
Because they're really interested in what kind of people are out there rather than just 2.
Yeah. Well, right. So you asked, you know, people are gullible and people aren't paying attention. They're casual about it. I was like, well, yeah, people are how they are. But if you give them a better set of choices, if you show them a game that's not rigged, they will actually be more interested in participating. And that's what we see from Oakland. I didn't raise that example as because that's definitely the absolute fix that we should do. And my point is that if we change the rules of the game, people will participate in a different way.
So
and the same thing is true on the money side.
So, and what's genius about that is this is a way to undermine the influence of the money.
It is.
So the Supreme Court can, you know, could just throw all the rules out and it wouldn't matter anymore because suddenly the money doesn't have any influence. And that's the way you have to go.
The money matters much less, exactly.
Yeah. But that's the way. That's pretty much what you have to look at in this current environment, right? Because it doesn't appear as if the Supreme Court is going to change its definition of corporate personhood or the limits on money.
It'll take us 10 or 20 or 30 years to change the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court over time moves from one set of rulings towards another sometimes, especially when it's completely out of sync with the public. Over time, it tends to move, but that's a long-term strategy. And there is actually a group of advocates who are working on this strategy, developing a different jurisprudence and so on. There are plenty of judges, including 4 members of the Supreme Court now, who think that the majority's rulings are just bad law. That it's an extremely constricted view of what corruption is, and a narrow interpretation of what corporate personhood, what it means. But it's certainly a long-term strategy. So in the meantime, we can work on other things like better information for voters through Citizen Initiative Review Panel, like Oregon's doing, we can bring that here. Like trying to move towards ranked choice and other improvements in the electoral system, initially at the local level and then maybe moving up towards the legislative level. And so that maybe by 10 years from now, there's enough experience that you could have a debate about doing it at the state level. There are things we can also do about the money in politics. Seattle came within 1,500 votes last year of passing a public funding system for candidates here. In cities like New York, where they use public funding, they use what they call a super match, it changes how candidates spend their time. They spend a lot more time doing voter contact, a lot less time on the phone raising money, and they raise money from a much more diverse array of citizens. So Seattle came very close, and there's a group here that's working on developing a measure that would come back to voters, I think, next year or maybe the year after to do public funding of campaigns in the city of Seattle. There's a resurgence of interest at the national level in groups like Common Cause and public campaign in finding some states that can be leaders on public finance. The Supreme Court has left a little avenue open in that domain. And it's, I'm not going to say that any of these things are easy, but there are paths. There are things we can do that could by 10 or 20 years from now leave us, put us in a very different position than we're in right now, where we just experienced a midterm election with $1 billion, so $300 million of dark money and $1 billion of independent expenditures, and a situation where candidates are spending 4 to 6 hours a day raising money.
We should talk about the dark money. Explain what that is and what the rules are on when you have to disclose your donors and when you don't.
So if you give, well, dark money is money where we don't know who the donor is, who the ultimate original source is, right? It's not a legal term that exists in the, it's a media term. But mostly what it refers to is giant sums of funds that flow through what are called social welfare organizations. So you guys have probably all heard of a 501c3. The League of Women Voters is probably a 501c3. That's a charity. 501c4 is a different part of the Internal Revenue Code. And those are organizations that are allowed to engage more in politics. So for years, the Sierra Club used to be a C4, am I getting that right? Many organizations now have a C3 and a C4, and over time, they develop legal theories and practices through which they can take lots and lots of money and publish or broadcast what they call issue advertisements,
right,
that never mention the candidate by name, but nonetheless have the effect of suggesting.
Well, they can also, I believe, say, call Patty Murray and tell her what you think.
Yeah.
As long as you don't say vote.
Exactly.
You're okay.
Exactly. So dark money is all that, and that's the fastest growing segment. You know, we had Citizens United, what is it now, 3 years ago? This year, 4 years ago, we had the McCutcheon ruling. McCutcheon ruling allows, eliminates the cap on how much any individual can give to candidates. It used to be that you could give no more than $62,000. Not very many people have $62,000 in a year.
Now, this is aggregate. There's still total. A limit on what you can give to an individual candidate.
That's right. This is a federal rule. There's a limit on how much you can give to any individual candidate. But, you know, frankly, there were always ways to get around that. You know, the folks say the history of money in politics is the story of water running downhill,
mm-hmm.
right? It will find its way. But you couldn't legally give more than $62,000 total, I might have that number wrong, but it's some big number, to all federal candidates. Now, McCutcheon blew up that rule. So now there are four or five ways you can give basically unlimited money to any candidate that you want. And the expectation was that was going to siphon more and more money directly to candidates, and that maybe we'd have shrinkage of the super PACs and the dark money through these social welfare organizations. That's not happened. Mm-hmm. What's happened instead is that the outside money, the super PACs and so on, has increased, presumably because the donors like to have control of it.
Yeah.
The Koch brothers and so on put in $225 million this cycle. We don't really know because it's dark money. Right. This is like they use the superconducting super collider to try to measure. they backcast from how much money was spent buying ads, and they try to figure out where it came from and so on. So $225 million from them, another 100 and something from Karl Rove's Crossroads. Right. Remember, Patty Murray has raised in her entire career $45 million. He raised $1.5 million running for Congress. These guys are dumping tens of millions of dollars through these shady channels. In Colorado, Senator Mark Udall lost his reelection bid. He was initially favored to win. Crossroads, the Karl Rove super PAC and social welfare group, spent $14 million just on TV ads against him, right?
I'd like to interrupt just this very minute, because one of the things I very much want to do is include the audience in the conversation.
I didn't even ask him questions yet. He's good.
And maybe he's the one to
is
be.
It time?
We should direct our questions to Dave. But something that my goal for everything is that all of us, having listened to this, we now have our own ideas, we have our own concerns. How can, I would like all of you, any of you, to come to the microphones, ask them questions, ask each other questions. We need to control it according to microphone. We can't have people just standing up and yelling questions. But I'm hoping that all of you have, there's a burning question there that you'd like them to answer, you'd like them to ask you, you'd like to ask each other. So I'd like to begin with that, and we'll start with Kathy over there.
Thank you. That was very enlightening and interesting. And this is a question for you and to a certain extent for the audience and Leaguers. I'm one of those proud progressives that has railed about the Koch brothers and all the money that the beverage industry and then the grocery industry has put into initiatives, and we talk about those bad rich people and whatever. And this week we passed 594 with the help of some very, very wealthy donors. And we've also seen Stiers from California, who's a huge environmental advocate and willing to put his money where his mouth is, and he's funding candidates that work for the environment. And it makes it a little bit less simple. They're not all, from my perspective, maybe all bad guys. And so I just wanted to throw that question out, and again, also for other League members and members of the audience. How do we feel when the shoe's on the other foot? And we have a Nick Hanauer putting a ton of money into what we consider to be a good cause that isn't necessarily self-serving in that case.
Yeah. Well, I think that what we've seen emerge in the last few years, and Soros was probably the earliest example of this, right, George Soros. There's piles of money on both sides now. A lot of people in the tech industry are distinctly progressive, and they throw their money in. I don't think that that's been the issue, though, lately. I mean, rich people have always been able to place a full-page ad in a newspaper for whatever cause they want. The change has been the money that goes directly to candidates, right?
Well, there's massively more money going into the issue of advertising as well, though.
Independent expenditures, for when I ran there, I raised 1.5, there were 2.5 million of non-coordinated independent expenditures that I couldn't control, and which I hated, frankly, because they, you know, they were the that kind of raw meat ad designed to scare people, that were aimed at my campaign and named me. They weren't just issues ads, they named me.
Yeah, without going into all of the categories, but we have, so you were in an open seat in one of these swing districts, right? So huge amounts of money coming in from all over. And because we've limited individual contributions directly to candidates, and that was before McCutcheon, so it was actually hard to get huge amounts of money directly to your opponent. Rich interests, whether they were PACs or individuals could do and still can do independent expenditures. If they do that and make it clearly against you, then they have to obey the rules of independent expenditures, which includes disclosure. Mm-hmm. So that's not dark money, right? You could have found out who the money was coming from, though they might have concealed it behind Americans for Prosperity,
right,
or something else. The grocery manufacturers tried to hide the name of their names of their donors a year ago, but ultimately the state attorney general succeeded in getting them to reveal. You know, let me go back to the original question and offer a thought about that, right? I can still root for my team, even if I think we need to change the rules, right? There's no conflict between supporting or being pleased that Tom Steyer's putting $57 million this year into supporting action on climate change, my team, right? And still thinking a system in which we depend on plutocrats to drive political change is not my, is not what democracy looks like.
That's a really excellent phrase, depending upon plutocrats. Joanna, would you like to ask a question?
So I think I'm following up a little bit on the idea that, of course, it's great. No, it seems nice when somebody well off donates money to a cause I believe in, but several things. One is that my understanding is that 594 likely would have passed without some of that last minute big donor money that they already had a lot. And so you have to say, well, maybe they just wanted to get on the bandwagon. Then you have to think, well, what is the effect on voter suppression when you have so much money going into negative campaigns? So that's still a real concern. Mm-hmm. And if you just compete for money, and the other issue is that a lot of times people will be big money will be supporting the people they really like. But even in presidential campaigns, I remember hearing, well, the banks are giving to Obama now, and that means it's because they think he's going to win because they weren't originally, because they want to be with the winner. So sometimes all that money goes to be with the winner mm-hmm. after they see mm-hmm. what's going to happen. But we're still not thinking about voter suppression. And then another small thing is, what do you think of maybe not allowing for paid signature gatherers?
I know he has an answer about money to the winners. I'm going to make a brief commercial announcement, and then we'll go to this question, okay? I brought flyers because I run a nonprofit, and that's what nonprofits do, is distribute flyers. So I'm going to pass them around. I also have sign-up sheets. If you want to get more information about the work that Sightline is doing about money and politics and other things, then you can put your name on this on one of the sign-up sheets, and I'll pick them up at the end of the day, at the end of the event. Okay.
After I won my primary election, fundraising got much, much easier. I started calling the next day, and I first call, I think I got $75,000, and then the next day I got another $80,000, because there are PACs there whose job it is to give to all the candidates, because they want your door to be open when they come to you to lobby for things. So, I mean, there's no question but that there is money going into both sides of the equation. But to me, it comes down to what exactly is that money buying. And in most cases, it's buying television ads designed to manipulate the choices of voters who haven't researched anything on their own. I mean, my wife especially, has never had any trouble making up her own mind, despite what all the ads say. And in fact, it's to the point where when you see a lot of negative ads against somebody, it has the reverse effect, because we all know by now, what's going on. Okay. On initiatives.
I'd like to give Susan a chance to ask a question.
I wanted to get Alan to talk a little bit about initiatives and paid signature gatherers, because there, once upon a time, you could not pay them. And that was, has now changed, right? Because
that's right.
Court decisions?
Washington outlawed paid signature gatherers in 1912, and they were illegal until the early 1980s, and unfortunately, it's a federal court ruling that prevents us from banning paid signature gathering. Oregon has a rule that says you can't pay them a direct bounty per signature, and Washington actually had that for a while, and a federal court here said, no, you can't do that. That's limiting people's speech, that is, the ability to pay people. So they're conflicting court rulings, actually, in the two states. But it seems like we can't do that. I think what we could do, we could have a disclosure requirement so that when someone asks you for your signature, they're required to say, hi, have you signed for whatever the initiative is, closing the gun loophole? I'll be paid $2 by the Committee for Gun Safety if you sign. I'll be paid $1.50 by the realtors if you sign this initiative against real estate taxes. I think we could do that. And that might be kind of good.
Could we move on? Because I want to give as many people as...
My question has to do with what the impact of all this money into campaign and election advertising is having on journalism. Because if all this money is going primarily to electronic media, how does that affect, or do we know how that affects independent and unbiased reporting on the candidates or the issues? Because if you're getting millions of dollars, that's pretty persuasive.
Based on what I've seen, I don't think it affects it. I've made fun of the ads back when I was doing a talk show. We've done parodies of them. I've come on after ads and said, by the way, that's not true. I don't do it often, but there's no denying that broadcasters make a lot of money during the political season because there are a lot of ads. And we like them because we don't have to go out beating the bushes to get people to spend money. They will spend it. And that, to a certain extent, is what gives us that kind of independence. They're going to buy those ads regardless of what we say because they are desperate to get that message out. Mm-hmm. I suppose where it might make a difference would be with certain ideological publications who, because, and I know this happens, if certain websites that are catering to an audience of a certain ideology, if they write editorials or write articles that buck that ideology, there can be severe consequences. I mean, sponsors can leave you for that. And not so much political sponsors, but corporate sponsors who don't like the message that you're sending.
Yeah.
Tony?
I would like to know if you know state legislators who have drawn up bills to provide for initiative reform or for this rank three choices in our state. Mm-hmm. Are there people that we should support who are starting in that direction?
Mm-hmm. You know, there have been a few bills, but they never really had enough support that they were real contenders. I think it's been a few years since anybody proposed a ranked choice system in Washington. Reuben Carlisle, state representative from 36th, has suggested a bill that would have public funding for state court races, which seems like a good place to start to me. Like for one thing, the races
didn't Tacoma try a ranked choice system?
Yeah, Pierce County did ranked choice for one cycle. Complicated story. Then they stopped. There are a few others, but they're all been kind of blips. And the problem is 96% of Americans believe that our system is too corrupted by big money. Our political system is too corrupted by big money. And 91% of Americans believe there's nothing we can do about it.
Yeah, but there is.
But there is.
So we need to know who the leaders are.
So the challenge is that everyone perceives this as a problem that you can't make progress on. Yeah. And we need to figure out some really, really smart strategies where we can make progress. And so that more legislators will see it's an area where it will advance their career, not hurt their career.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to interrupt quickly to say I would like to have at least two more people speak. It is now after 7:15, so we really need to move quickly through the rest of the evening. And Samantha, you be next.
My question, I think, dovetails on that pretty nicely. And I feel that quite a number of, certainly the people we know, are smart enough people to vote. It's just that they often feel that they cannot find, or within a good hour of internet research, can't find accurate information that they can trust to make the decisions that they need to make. So I think that one of the most effective things we can do is to create some resources that they truly can trust. Not everybody knows about the League of Women Voters, but like that Citizens Committee that you were talking about, something that they can go to rather than hunting through a bunch of different websites and never trusting any of them, never trusting the newspapers. So I think, you know, there must be some things that we can do to make it easier for people who are willing to research to find information that they can trust.
Well, I think those sites exist. The Metropolitan Council of Seattle, the King County Bar Association, the judges' races are the toughest ones for me, and the King County Bar Association has a site where they rate the judges. So you can either go by their ratings or you can read deeper into why they earn those ratings. And of course, the voters' pamphlet. I've never had a problem just, you know, going to Google, getting information about a candidate. And then, of course, you have to use your judgment to decide whether the source is trusted or not. But I don't think that's going to change anytime soon. The internet is getting bigger, not smaller.
Mm-hmm. I will say that that academics who study this question about voter participation, particularly who studied what gets people to vote all the way down the ballot, suggest that more information is not the solution. That's a sort of pointy-headed, overeducated perspective, like I would have, that instead what's happened is that we've had a decline of what they call mediating organizations, that the decline of, they call it social capital also, but we're not as much a society made up of lots and lots of local organizations and fraternal organizations and clubs and labor unions and churches and so on and so forth, and those are the settings that provide the information that have historically provided information to the swing voters, who are not at this event. Swing voters are the people who are actually the target of those ads, right? About 90% of Americans actually have some sort of a political ideology. Only about, what's said is that a third of Americans are independents. Now, that's not really right. A third are willing to admit that they're progressive conservatives, and a quarter are willing to admit that they're liberals. And then there's another big chunk on each side who, if pressed, will admit that they actually have a political ideology and it is a little more conservative or a little more liberal. But there is about 10% in the middle who really don't know what they think at all. Those are the actual swing voters. And they are paying attention to, I don't know what, football, something else. Right, and they decide the future of the free world.
And Dana? Thank you, Janet. Before I ask my very brief question, I would like to let Janet and the League know that I do know how to reach Superman's personal trainer. It's my brother, so actually I can help us with this training to be Superman. Second, my question is, Bernie Sanders is floating this idea this week, and I'd like to get your comments on whether this making voting day a national holiday would actually help to change voter behavior or in turnout.
Well, I don't know. We thought that mail-in ballots would create 100% participation. I mean, you've got 2 weeks to vote, for crying out loud, and sitting on your kitchen table. So, and I know that many areas now have early voting. If you're where you're still voting in person, they let you vote early and before hours and after hours. So, I don't know if, I mean, I'm happy to have another day off. I don't know if it
would. Another proposal is sometimes that you could have elections on the weekend, all weekend maybe. Mm-hmm. The polls would be open. I think Washington and Oregon, and now California, the vote-by-mail system is something that other states ought to adopt. It does increase participation by a few percentage points. Alone, it doesn't fix everything. The other thing that Oregon almost did that would make a big difference, Oregon last year came within one vote in the state Senate of doing what they call automatic voter registration. You know, in most countries, it's the job of the government to register voters. Here, the League of Women Voters does it, and, you know, Washington bus and the parties and so on and so forth. But Oregon, we do have motor voters, so you're asked, would you like us to register the vote, right? When you go to a state agency and get an ID. What Oregon was going to do, and came one vote in the state Senate from doing, was to make the default position that we're going to register you. So, you're here to renew your license or whatever it is. We're registering you for to vote. If you'd like to unregister, here's a postcard, which you can send in. The estimates was that this was going to increase the voter rolls by about 500,000 people in Oregon. Now, would all those people vote? No, but they're going to get a ballot delivered to their door whenever there's an election, and participation would probably go up by tens of thousands of voters. Just, we do know that, that when your ballot arrives, you get a few more percent participation. Free postage would also help?
Postage, yeah.
Yeah, free postage.
I think I could solve this problem pretty easily. You just announce that 10 ballots will get $5,000.
Yes. Okay.
We'll pick 10, though.
I get to be the one to interrupt this wonderful conversation and tell you that we're at an end. That's at an end. But they're going to stick around, by the way, so everybody can corral them later, maybe around the wine there.